Greenwood Gab.
Welcome back to Greenwood Gab. I'm Natalie.
And I'm Sarah.
And we're back with another Southside Reads episode.
Because that's all we do, right? Librarians, we just read and read and read. Actually, you and I are really like leaning into that stereotype because we both are trying to read a lot of books this year.
Yeah, I'm almost at my goal. I've read 136 books so far this year.
That's a lot. I'm only trying to read 90. So I'm a little bit behind you.
My goal is 145. I started out as 100, but I got there in like September. So, but I've been slowing down, so I need to catch back up. I only have like, what, 2 weeks left? So
I know, but 2 weeks of lovely vacation time.
Yes, winter break.
Yay. So I'm hoping to knock out quite a few books in the next couple of weeks.
Yeah, I only have to read 9. I can probably do it. But today we're not talking about what we haven't read yet. We are talking about what we've already read for the end of Southside Reads 2023. So I think we left off with September.
Yeah, that was the last one we did.
So we're going to start talking about October and throw it back to spooky season with our mysterious reads category.
But before we do that, let's play some transition music.
Oh, yeah.
So now we can officially begin.
It's time. So I guess since I've been starting, I can start this part. So my October read was in an anthology. It's hard to say syllables that repeat. It was an anthology called Out There Screaming, an anthology of new black horror by Jordan Peele. Well, edited by Jordan Peele. It was lots of different authors. I don't remember. It's like 15, maybe, short stories. It's a lot of short stories about various topics. So it's different horror. So there's like supernatural and there's like a technology horror story. And then there's just like, you know, true horror of everyday life that's also included. And since it is an anthology, I'm not really sure how to review it. I recommend it. I really liked it, but the stories are just so different. So some of the titles I'll read off. There's one called Eye and Tooth, which is like a supernatural one. Sarah and I were kind of talking about this before we started recording. I think that's the one about the dolls. So, you know, stereotypical creepy doll story.
Are dolls ever not creepy?
No, they're always creepy. Unless we're like talking about Barbie, you know.
Even
she
then,
had her time this summer.
They're still weird Barbie.
That's true. So some of the other titles, there's one called Hide and Seek, Your Happy Place, which doesn't necessarily tell you that it's a horror story, but it is. Flicker, Pressure, Invasion of the Baby Snatchers, and Reckless Eyeballing. And of course, like that's the first story, and that's the one I remember the most. It's there's a police officer who pulls over cars because he can see like eyes on them. So that's how he decides which cars to pull over. And then there's like eyeballs just start popping up sort of everywhere in his life. And there's just creepy eyeballs. So I do recommend it. But that's what I read for Mysterious Reads. What did you read?
Creepy eyeballs. Nothing with creepy eyeballs.
Oh, that's disappointing.
I read Did You Hear About Kitty Carr by Crystal Smith Paul. And this one is historical fiction, but there is a mysterious twist to it in that in present day, there is an esteemed actress of like a kind of golden age of Hollywood who has died, and she's left all of her worldly goods to these three black sisters. And the mystery is why, what is their connection? So we know that the mother of these three daughters was on a television show with the actress Kitty Carr in like the 70s. So we know that there is connection between these two families in that sense, but it's still kind of shocking that she would leave everything to these three girls. And then you quickly kind of zoom back in time to the rural South. You learn about this young woman who is born into poverty, whose mother was sexually assaulted by a gentleman that she worked for. And she's working still in this household and kind of with this, the matron of the house knows that this young girl is her granddaughter, but also won't acknowledge it publicly. So it's like this nice birthday cake shows up every year on her birthday, but, you know, they don't talk about it. And the housekeeper and her daughter are African American, and the family, of course, is white. And so how does this young girl grow up, and how does her story then align with Kitty Carr and these three women? That's the mystery of it all, kind of looking at Hollywood and race relations and things people do to survive.
Wow. Mysterious.
I mean, that was the aim, right? Well, speaking of mysteries, we move into November's theme, which is recommended reads. And our Southside Reads book discussion group that meets once a month, we are very into our mysteries and thrillers. They come up a lot. Mm-hmm. So I read another mystery for November. Recommended by, I think, Southside Reads' number one fan, mm-hmm. Barbara Smith. She is a huge fan of William Kent Krueger. She and Joellen Peterson, who was on the podcast, and Vicky Page even took a pilgrimage, if you will, to West Virginia to see him at a book festival there. So in honor of that voyage and in honor of Barbara Smith, I read Ordinary Grace by William Kent Krueger, another one that's a blend of mystery and historical fiction. It's about a kind of young boy transitioning into young adulthood. He gets caught up in a mystery surrounding some deaths that happen in his community in the, guessing, early 60s, if I can remember. I don't remember exactly when, but it has that kind of time feel to it. And it reminded me a lot of It by Stephen King. Mm-hmm. There isn't any, like, creepy clowns in the sewers or anything like that, but just really being immersed into this rural community in the 60s and these kids who just kind of run around and have a lot of independence and are trying to figure out who they are and how they fit into the world and the ways in which we learn as we grow older that our parents aren't perfect and that there's a lot going on that we kind of aren't aware of until we start growing up. So I enjoyed it. And I would recommend William Kent Krueger. I think he does a really good job of creating a sense of place. Like, I really saw this small community in the Midwest, and I liked. How about you? What'd you read?
Well, I considered reading William Kent Krueger, but then I happened across another book to read instead. So I sort of, well, I'm one of the people who recommended this author, so I sort of recommended a book to me. But Sarah and I both read S.A. Cosby back in May for Virginiana, local author who's actually from near my hometown, which is fun. And I was at a independent bookstore recently and found a copy of his debut novel, My Darkest Prayer. So since I owned that one, I figured I would read it for Southside Reads for November. And it is like a reprint of his debut. So there's a foreword by the author about how it is his debut novel. And while he's proud of it, he recognizes that he still had things to learn. But I really enjoyed this book. I like flew through it. It's about a man who works at a funeral home. And he like used to be sheriff, I think sheriff. He was a police officer anyway, for this town called Queen County in Virginia, which is fictional. It's actually King and Queen County in Virginia. And there's a death of a local minister, and some ladies from the church don't think the police handled his death well. They think he was murdered. So they turn to, his name is Nathan, so they ask him to investigate the death of this minister. And they knew that he used to be like a gang member and be into drugs and stuff, and he was reformed and he found God and became a minister. But it's very trying not to rhyme, but it's very sinister, the death of the minister.
It's like a creepy Dr. Seuss book.
Yeah. So, and there is like, you know, sex and drugs and things involved in this death that the main character then finds out about. And then he like has his own issues throughout the story too. And there's lots of fights and violence, but there were like moments of levity. Like I laughed and like giggled a lot. Some at like just things that were funny, but also it's just fun to recognize places that the author was putting into the book that are actually in real King and Queen County. I really enjoyed it.
I mean, I think second only to William Kent Kruger is S.A. Cosby in the like recommended reading in our group. It, yes, you know, you and I kind of started it with the Virginiana theme, but then a lot of other members have now read him. Mm-hmm. Gotta support our local Virginia authors, and S.A. Cosby is really kind of come into his own, it seems, this year with All the Sinners Bleed has gotten a lot of press. And
yep, it's gotten a lot of awards, deservedly so. So then we round out the month with Wild Card.
We've made it to December.
Yeah, and for December, we're letting people read whatever they want to.
Because it's hard to read in December when, I mean, Natalie and I, we are like, yes, 2 weeks off to read. But most people are like 2 weeks off to spend time with my family and go shopping and eat and stuff. And so we thought Wild Card would be fitting. Just read whatever you want because lots is happening.
Mm-hmm. And we have already talked to the other Southside Reads members and people have read a variety of things. So it works out to kind of give people free rein sometimes. I mean, we let people interpret our themes however they want to, but this one is a lot more open than others, unless you're me. So I went real literal this month and read a book called Wild Card by Barry Coleman. And I did not enjoy it. So the premise is it's about this scientist, I guess, who discovers the cure for the common cold. So that's kind of what drew me in. So the title, obviously, and then this like idea that a scientist can cure the common cold and then the kind of ramifications of that. So all these other countries like want the cure, you know, to profit off of it, to make money. So that's sort of the premise. Like people are trying to get the formula from him, and through that, there's lots of like action and people are like trying to go after him and murder him. And then there's plane crashes and boat crashes and too much action, in my opinion, like action for the sake of action that doesn't actually do anything to the story. It's just there. I don't know. And I listened to the audio and I didn't enjoy the narrator either, which I did look him up and he has narrated lots of other books.
So but you know just, what books not to listen to now.
Yeah. First of all, I like to speed up my audiobooks, which is a me thing. I totally recognize that, but it was already hard to understand his accent. And then when I tried to speed it up, I couldn't listen to it. So it was painfully long. Like it was way too long. It needed an editor. And then this narrator, like I couldn't make go faster, just made it painful to get through. I don't know what else to say. I did not like it. If you like action and really long books, then maybe you will like it, but not for me. It was too much. I like the premise. It could have been more than it was, and it just wasn't good. So hopefully you liked your, or are liking your December pick. So,
yeah. So I was thinking about it and I read a lot. So I have read some books already in December. But what I decided to share with you all and what I shared when Southside Reads met, I am a book nerd, which is not surprising. And sometimes that book nerdness really nerds out. And
how many times can we say the word nerd and anthology in this episode?
So what I did this year, Goodreads is a social media site for keeping track of the books you're reading, the books you've read. You can, you know, communicate with other readers. You can get recommendations. It's a great site for people who like to read. And they do a award season every year where they take some books that were popular on their website and have their readers vote for their favorites. So what I decided to do this year was to take the nominees that were up and do some calculating, looking at some of the statistics that are available through Goodreads and make some predictions about what books I thought might win, and then try to read as many of those books as I could. So I did read two of the winners based on my calculations, and I read some other ones that just happened to be winners that I'd already read earlier in the year. But the one I'm going to talk about now is a book I thought might win for the historical fiction category, because apparently these 3 months I wanted to read historical fiction every month. It did not. Another book I read earlier in the year did win. So I still read the historical fiction category, but not this one, The Covenant of Water by Abraham Verghese, I think is how you pronounce his last name. He wrote Cutting for Stone, which I read and enjoyed. And this one is another kind of epic historical fiction novel. I'm only halfway through, which in any other book I would be finished, because I'm like 400 pages in. But this one, it's like I said, an epic historical fiction work. So I'm just halfway, but it's about this community of people who live on the southwestern coastal area of India. It starts in the year 1900 with a young girl being married off, and you've learned more about her life after that marriage. But then there's also weaved in stories of English people who live in India, other people who have emigrated to India, as well as people from India. In this time period, there's a lot about separation from England, because that happens in the 20th century. And so there's a lot of kind of political stuff that comes up in the way people interact. There's a lot about like the caste system and how that works within like the English system. It's been very fascinating and interesting, and it's really immersive. You really can see and imagine these locales, and the people are really well developed, and you really get to know each character. It's pretty epic. I think it says in the description I'm looking at right now, it's spanning the years 1900 to 1977. Mm. It follows three generations of a family. And like I said, some miscellaneous other characters who interweave with that family in that time period. Very good. It didn't win historical fiction, but I think it came in second place. Maybe, I can't remember now, in votes. So it still was, my calculations weren't too far off.
Speaking of the Goodreads Awards, I will say Southside readers were a little disappointed that both S.A. Cosby and William Kent Kruger were nominated in the mystery
thriller.
Yeah. And neither won.
Neither won. That is this installment of Southside Reads on Greenwood Gab. What was it? Gugu Surit.
Yes. Greenwood Gab, Southside Reads Extravaganza time. That's where it comes in.
Yes. Extravaganza.
For those of you who don't listen to the whole episode and miss out on the bloopers at the end.
I know. Go back and listen to all the bloopers. They're the best part.
Yes.
All right. So now we're going to transition to another activity. Are you ready?
Sure.
So it is, some might say, the most wonderful time of the year coming up. And so I had a fun idea based on a podcast that I listened to. So this is very meta. So I listened to this podcast that talked about this thing, and I was like, we should talk about this thing on our podcast. And that thing is Victorians and their creepy Christmas cards.
Creepy.
Or unusual, not Christmas cards. The Victorians invented the Christmas card because it became much more affordable to send things through the mail, and printing was very popular, like printing images and things like that. So Christmas cards kind of became a thing during the Victorian time. But their idea of what makes a Christmas card is a little odd. And you may be thinking, well, Sarah, Christmas cards are things you look at. How are we going to do that on a podcast? And my challenge for Natalie is to paint a picture with words. I'm going to show her some of my favorites, and she's going to tell you what Victorians put on their Christmas cards. So
I'm scared.
Okay. Card number one.
It's a mouse riding a lobster. I don't understand what's happening. With a list. So the mouse is riding a lobster and holding on to like its antenna. Do lobster have antenna? Is that what that is?
I think so.
So he's holding on to the antenna with one hand, tiny mouse hand. And in his other tiny mouse hand, he has a list of names.
It's actually a French term.
Okay. I don't know French. Do you know what they say?
Yeah, it's peace, joy, health, and like good tidings.
Okay.
In French on a list.
And it must be like a sunny day because there's like a giant shadow underneath them too. So it's like creepy black shadow. And then this list that says peace, joy, and happiness or whatever you just said.
Yeah, well, that's the Christmas part, right? We still wish people peace and joy and good health and all of that on Christmas, but not typically with a rodent on a lobster's back.
Yeah. Yeah. Interesting. Okay. I wasn't sure what to expect, and now...
Next.
This one's even weirder, maybe. I don't know. The lobster mouse one is weird, but now we're at frogs. And one frog has stabbed another frog in the heart, I guess. Is that where a frog's heart is? So this frog is like laying on the ground with a knife in its middle with blood running out of it, while another frog, the stabber, is running away with like a bag of money. So Christmas robbery. And is that supposed to be like $2,000? It has the number 2,000 on it.
Maybe pounds, shillings.
Yeah. I mean, it's like, it's a little bag. So there's definitely coins in there. Oh, and the frog is wearing, so the stabber that's running away is wearing an orange like vest and blue striped pants.
But the stabbed frog is naked.
Yeah.
I don't know what that means. Why is one clothed and one naked?
And then at the bottom it says, a Merry Christmas to you. Nothing says Christmas like murder and robbery. And is that like a bayonet or something on the ground? Like, what is that?
Where?
Or is that part of his foot?
I think
that might be part
foot.
Of his foot. I just want it to be some weapon. But he already used the knife or sword or whatever.
Dagger.
That is. Yeah. Okay. God, these are ridiculous. Okay, so tamer. What does that say? The compliments of the season at the bottom. And we have a monkey painting a dog sitting as a model. And then there's another monkey kind of creeping around the corner with some sort of weapon, I'm assuming.
Yeah, we're not sure exactly what that
like. What's he doing? It's very sinister. Like, I'm about to come bash you on the head while you're painting your friend. I don't know.
And why is the monkey painting the dog?
Yeah.
He also, I don't know. There's like something in his hand other than just the paintbrush and the palette. Mm-hmm. What's that like long thing?
Yeah, it looks kind of like a feather or something.
Maybe.
Is it like attached to the palette maybe?
Maybe. Yeah. Maybe it's like a second brush when he needs to get the finer details.
Maybe. I mean, the dog looks like very regal, like good posture, sitting up straight, posing for a portrait.
That a monkey is painting.
Yeah, that a monkey is painting. All right, so frogs again.
Because nothing says Christmas like frogs. Yeah. No murder this time.
Frogs, is that a lightning bug? Maybe? Like over here?
Or like a dragonfly?
Maybe dragonfly? Because well, the rest of them are dragonflies. So there's some more like, so there's some bugs flying in the background in the abyss. There are some bugs that look like dragonflies. So maybe this foreground one is also a dragonfly. And then there's a frog dancing with a cockroach. May Christmas be merry.
I mean,
and it looks like they're on a beach, maybe.
Yeah.
Like ocean behind them and then sky, the lighter blue. And what is the dragonfly lightning bug thing holding?
I think it's a tambourine. I think he's playing a little tune for the frog and the cockroach to dance to.
See, and the tambourine is yellow. So that's kind of what was giving me the light. So I was like, oh, lightning bug. But it's not. His butt doesn't light up. Just the thing he's holding.
Yeah. Also, in what world is a cockroach the same size as a frog?
Oh, yeah. They're definitely the same height.
And why would you ever want to live in that world?
I mean, it's either, or maybe both, a very big cockroach and a very small frog.
It's a terrifying world for Christmas. But that's supposed to be merry.
They're just having a merry time dancing on the beach together. Last one, best one. Oh, my God. So this one actually has a human child in it, I'm assuming. So it says, a Christmas greeting with love. And there's, it's like a cross between a teacup and a tea kettle.
Yeah, I think it's like just like a fancy teapot.
Fancy teapot that's open. And then the child is in the teapot. And it looks like a very happy child.
Does he look happy?
She said sarcastically. Like, looks like they would rather be anywhere else. It's like, why do you make me sit in the teacup and hold this card that says a Christmas greeting with love?
Or is the child being boiled alive in that teapot? That's my question.
Or when I said human child, maybe is the child just part of the teacup? Like it's a teacup with a head and arms.
But I mean, the child's definitely coming out of the top. I think someone's boiling this child alive.
I mean, they just look like hot and tired.
Are we done yet?
I don't know. I think I prefer the frogs.
That frog?
Yeah. Or the murder frogs.
Dancing with a cockroach or murdering, which is your favorite frog?
I think I prefer the dancing with the cockroach one. Yeah, it's like Christmas in Florida.
They do have those giant like palmetto bug cockroaches in that part of the world.
Hey, you know what I just realized? This kind of fits in with the December wild card theme.
Yeah.
Look at us. Totally did that on purpose.
Completely.
We're talking about cards for wild card. And they have been wild.
So I guess, is that what we have for this segment of wild cards?
Yeah, I think so. Unless you've got more creepy cards. Maybe next year. Stay tuned for next December.
Maybe I'll find creepy, like, happy birthday Victorian cards. I feel like the Victorians were creepy.
They like creepy, like Valentine's Day cards. I could see this as a Valentine's Day card.
Because nothing says love like a cockroach and a frog dancing while a dragonfly plays the tambourine. And now we just have to say,
Have a great.
And see you in 2024. I hope 2023 was everything you wanted it to be. And 2024 is even better. All right. I'm going to play just a snippet of a song. Because I feel like because I'm the only one that can hear things, like I keep starting things, but
I can start. Just point at me.
Okay. I'll give you a pointing.